Good morning. I'm going to welcome you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the day that the Lord has made, and be glad in it. Praise God. We have something a little bit different. Well, it's a really big difference. We're having a congregational meeting before we get into the main body of the worship for the election of a deacon candidate. The nominating committee has proposed and has put before you Tom Richard. So we're going to organize that right. We're going to organize that right out immediately after the announcements. Do we have announcements today? Yes, we have something to back.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Fellowship reminds you that after worship today, please join us for a snack and chat, an all-American snack and chat. See you then.
And you can smell something cooking back there, so it's wonderful. So please join us. Any other announcements? Yes, Zach.
Hi,
thank you, Zach. And we all look forward to Summer Semester Week that starts on the 17th, right? Super. Other announcements? Not seeing any, then let us commence with our congregational meeting. The first thing is, do we have a quorum? Where's Susie?
Yes.
We have a quorum, okay. So let's open with prayer. Dear Lord, we ask your presence on this brief congregational meeting to elect a deacon candidate. And we thank you so much for your presence with us and your love for us, and ask you to be with us as we seek to do your will. In your son's holy name, amen. If I can do this on behalf of Jen, is that all right, Jen? Presenting the nomination, the slate. The slate is Peggy Pryle, who said yes to being a deacon candidate, was unable to, had to withdraw because of health issues and personal issues, and so we want to send our love and prayers out to her. But then after the election of church officer candidates, the nominating committee went to Tom Richards, who agreed to be a deacon candidate. And so he has gone through the training, and he's actually gone through the examination. And so contingent upon the election, his election now, he will come up and be ordained and installed as a deacon. However, this being a congregational meeting, if there's someone else who feels that they or someone else would like to be a deacon, they can put their name forward. We'll probably then suspend the meeting and do it at the end of this, after worship, but that is allowable. So the first thing we do is you've been presented the slate, which is Tom Richards to replace Peggy Pryle, as well as that has come from the committee, come from the session, so it's fully approved. But there's always, so we have to open the floor to nominations from the floor. So is there any nominations from the floor? Okay, not seeing any. Is there a motion to close the nominations from the floor? Is there a second? Mike, John Federcal, and then Mike Galliano seconded. Great. Is there any discussion on that? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Now let's vote on Tom Richards. Is again, the motions come from the committee. It does not need a second. All those in favor of Tom Richards being elected as a deacon candidate say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. Okay, so the motion is carried. So he will be ordained and installed as he when everyone else is. So is there a motion now to close the congregational meeting? Jim, is there a second? Dave Broadwater in the back. Any opposition? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, no. We're done. So let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for this wonderful, wonderful congregational meeting. In your son's holy name, amen. So that was, wouldn't it be nice if all of them were that brief? Having said that, if there are no other announcements, then let us center ourselves on the worship of God.
I thought on this rainy day we'll get things moving a little bit.
Let us join together in our responsive call to worship. Blessed is the man who walks not in counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seats of scoffers.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord,
and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree planted by the streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all he does, he prospers.
The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous.
For the Lord knows the way of the righteous,
but the way of the wicked will perish.
Let us worship God.
To share you.
Let us go to God in unison and ask for his mercy and grace. O God of hope and faith, we come to you in celebration,
because we know you are with us at all times. However our hearts mourn and lament our continual sin and its consequences upon us and those we love, forgive us when we turn from you. Call us back into right relationship so that we can find rest and peace in your loving arms.
In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Christian friends, we gather every Sunday to not just hear the word of God proclaimed, but to come back into right relationship with God so that we can not only hear him, but that we can do what he calls us to do. And the joy of our salvation tells us that he is there at all times, continually with us to draw us back to himself. So hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. Let's continue to stand and share together our affirmation of faith, which is found in the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
Let us pray that God will open our hearts and minds. Father God, you have shown us what is good and to open our eyes and ears to truth. Give words to our faith so that we can share it with those who come into our lives. Empower us not only to share what we believe, but live each day in the grace and love you have extended to your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Our first reading comes from the Apostle Paul's letter to Titus, chapter 1, verses 1 through 16 in the English Standard Version. Paul, a servant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of faith of God, elect in their knowledge and of truth, out of the truth, which accords with godliness, and hope for eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began, and at the proper time manifested in his word through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God our Savior, to Titus, my true child in a common faith. Grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Savior. This is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above reproach, the husband of one wife and his children are believers and not open to the charge of debauchery or insubordination. For the overseer, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He must not be arrogant or quick-tempered or a drunkard or violent or greedy for gain, but hospitable, a lover of good, self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught, so that he may be able to give instruction in sound doctrine and also to rebuke those who contradict it. For those are many who are insubordinate, empty talkers, and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision party. They must be silenced, since they are upsetting whole families by teaching for shameful gain what they ought not to teach. One of the Cretans, a prophet of their own, said, "Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. Therefore rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith, not devoting themselves to Jewish myths or in the commands of people who turn away from the truth. To the pure, all things pure, but to the turn away from the truth. To the pure, all things that are pure, but to the defiled, the unbelieving, nothing is pure, but both their minds and their consciences are defiled. They profess to know God, but they deny him by their works. They are detestable, disobedient, unfair for any good work." May the Lord bless this reading and our understanding of his most holy word.
Catch shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? 'Cause I am yours, I'm
Can this bottle make any more noise? I love that video, and I think that's really appropriate for our sermon today. And I love the pictures that went with it. I must admit, but my mind went to that one picture of Jesus with that little child, and there's a yellow lab right next to him. Anyone remember that picture? I'm going, what's the deal with the yellow lab? Then I thought about my sermon, my pastor's pen, Dog Days of Summer. If you haven't read it, read it. But it tells, do dogs go to heaven? Read the article, you'll find out. Anyway, our passage today continues to look at what Timothy says on about not just scripture, but now about preaching. But it also applies how we as Christians, as brothers and sisters of faith, and as the elders and the deacons and the officers of the church are called, what is our responsibility? And we'll look at that. So hear these words, 2 Timothy 4:1-8. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears that will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As to you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. For I am already being poured out as a drink offering, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who has loved his appearing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Don't you love the expression, what's your point? You're talking and talking and someone says, excuse me, what's your point? Don't you love when that happens? Well, that is appropriate to ask that question, especially sometimes we can miss the point. But when we look at what the marks of the church are, there's four of them. The first is where the pure preaching of the gospel is proclaimed. Now, the other one would be where the sacraments are correctly administered, and then where church discipline is exercised. The last is where fellowship is maintained, and we're having fellowship afterwards, so praise God. But to focus on the first one, in order to ensure that this mark occurs, God in Christ calls elders and deacons as spiritual leaders to hold each other and the church accountable to ensure this occurs. And so let's speak on that. And again, as I said, when someone says, you know, what's your point? You might ask yourself, well, I thought I was making my point. And sometimes it can feel insulting, but if they're asking with sincerity, you should respond with sincerity. Now, Isaac Newton, we think of him as a physicist, we think of him as a mathematician. He said, tact is the art of making a point without making an enemy. Because sometimes in the points we seek to make, our passions can overwhelm us and we can make a point in what might be described a harsh or critical manner. But tact, The ability to say it softly, but still say it, can make the point without making an enemy. But sometimes we need to get to the point. We need to sharpen the message we want to make. We want to use the words that would matter and get us to where we need to go. So that's an important thing. Because if we're lost in understanding, some people will just nod their head and smile. Or some people will get in their frustration and say, what's your point? I remember my, not that I ever have a problem making my point clear, but my father-in-law would often ask me, not often, he asked me a couple of times, what's your point? I said, I have no point. And then I would stop. But if I reflected, I said, well, he was trying to understand me and I probably wasn't being as clear as I could be. So how do we make our point and be heard? Because that's what ultimately everyone wants. They want to be heard. They want to others to see value in what they think and what they say. And so sometimes it's important to sharpen the ability to do that. So here are some just seven real quick ways of making your point. Provide a context. Get to the point quickly. Jesus saves. I've got to the point. So that's the point I'm trying to make in every sermon I have. But let's just say it in a different way. If you're not understood the first time, ask for a response. Use I statements. If you already have strong feelings, name them. And get feedback on how your communication comes across. But I think number seven is the one that I want to focus on, especially when it applies to making a point in how you share the gospel, share the good news. George W. Bush, who is known for a good turn of phrase, said verbosity leads to unclear, inarticulate things. Now, how many of us understand what the word verbosity means? Now, I don't know, and I don't even know if I understand what it means, but apparently he thought that was clear, but some people might say, not quite. Not as well as it could. He was trying to make a point. But oftentimes what George W. Bush, and this is nothing about his politics, sometimes the things he would say would be confusing. Misremembering, that became into our vocabulary from last week. I talked about new words. Misremembering became into our vocabulary because of George W. Bush. So sometimes the words that are used can be make it unclear, the point unclear, confused, lost, many different things, puzzling. So we have to make our point clearly. So let's look at what Scripture says. In Mark 16, 15, Jesus said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to all the creation. So this is a command that Jesus gives us. Go into the world and proclaim the gospel to all nations, to everyone, to all creation. So a question that can be asked is, how do I know if I'm being called to preach? Because is proclaiming the gospel to all creation preaching? Some would say yes, and I would be one of them. Sure. That proclamation and preaching are synonymous. They're the same word. So what does that mean for us? As individuals, as elders, as deacons, as members of the church. Now, there's a variety of preaching styles out there. There's illustrative preaching. There is thematic preaching. And I don't know if anyone knows, but the style I use most is called expository preaching. And expository preaching is to look at a verse and explain the verse, seeking context, seeking understanding, and pulling out the words and the meanings that are important that we need to understand, and feeling that this is something that I was called to do by God, to use that particular style. Not every style of preaching uses that. However, I have found that style works for me, and it lifts up Scripture as primary more than any of the others I've used. So Paul says, when I preach the gospel, I have no reason to boast because I am obligated to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. And in the same way, if you're called to preach each and every week, then woe to me, woe to that person if they don't do it. That's a calling, they have to do it. Like this individual, he knows what he needs to do, doesn't he? He's got that handout. He's, you know, sporting that mustache, those glasses, that plaid shirt. He knows that he is called to preach the good word. Praise God. But some of us aren't as assured of that. And even if we are, as members of the congregation, are we seeking to be aware of what we are called to beware? Do you understand what I'm saying? Was that verbosity? Was that clear? Did I make my point? Because we are told in 2 Peter, and in many places, we saw it in Titus as well, the passage that, you know, Adam read from the letter to Titus. I didn't know, I forgot how much Paul did not like the Cretans. What are they, lazy gluttons, whatever? Yeah. But he says there, he also says here, there will also be false teachers among you, secretly introducing destructive heresies, even denying the master who brought them, bringing swift destruction upon themselves. Are we aware that we're supposed to beware of that? Clearly we should be, because Scripture calls us to that. So every time someone stands in the pulpit or up on the chancel, anywhere they may be, are you listening to be aware of what you're called to beware of? Because false teachers are out there, and they're on with this list. I found this list, which I agree with, but they had this whole long other list of false teachers. I'm not going to name who was on that list. Some of them you may know, because they may do these things. They may preach a health, wealth, prosperity gospel. They may incorporate New Age teaching into what they're saying. They had that name it, claim it, your words create your own destiny, twist scripture to fit their own teachings, or have secret scripture that only they or their leadership of that particular denomination knows of. They don't preach Jesus of the Bible, they preach Jesus of a secondary source. And some say money will determine your blessing from God. The more you give, the more you get. All those are false teaching, and I would think most of us, if not all of us, would recognize that. But it can come in subtle ways. But when we preach the gospel, preach the good news, are we aware of that as something that God has called us to not only do, but to hear? The pure and high gospel we preach is the proclamation of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which is Christ and the church. If you hear anything beyond that, you have to question it. So let's get to truth 101. Some of the basic things we need to know. Elders and deacons. Today, one of the things we're going to do is we're going to install and ordain elders and deacons. And we have a wonderful group that is going to be brought forward. And we're going to be saying goodbye to those who are leaving the elder and deacon board. We will say goodbye to Pearl Montgomery, who's been an excellent president of the deacons, with Wanda Nowicki, who's done a great job, with Katie Waggett, we all know, who passed away. We miss her. We know that Kate Mincy and Carrie Richards are going to go for a second term, which you voted on and approved, and as well as Dan Cork and Mike Carney are rotating off and having a well-deserved rest. So this is your deacon, the deacons that are leaving, but we have four elders coming back on, as well as three deacons. So what are the qualifications the Bible gives for elders and deacons? Shouldn't we seek that truth? Now here's a wonderful, you know, like a Venn diagram where there's a two circles where they intertwine. You see on one end the requirement for the elders, the other end for the deacons, and you see the ones in the middle that both elders and deacons are supposed to have. And some of my question says, you're going to see women coming forward to be elders and deacons. So isn't the first one wife sort of discounting their ability? And the answer is, we as brothers and sisters of Christ within our denomination and our agreement understand that women are called to ministry. Because in Christ, there's neither Jew nor Greek, slave or free, male or female. We're all one in Christ. So we see that truth speaking to the need, the calling for women to be in ministry. So we see this as a contextual, that one particular phrase, contextual within that time, But in our time, we accept women and affirm and lift up women as elders and deacons and ministers. But let's look at elders for just a brief time. You know, three of the callings that elders are supposed to have is, in our denomination, we say leadership, governance, and discipline. That's the responsibilities. But here it says leading, shepherding, and teaching. Sometimes elders might not quite understand that they have a calling just like the pastors do. In fact, I'm an elder. I'm a teaching elder. Whereas the ones we're installing or ordaining today are ruling elders. But just as a teaching elder, ruling elders have a responsibility to lead, to shepherd, and to teach. So what is the biblical role of elders in today's church? Now again, you see that list of 15 above reproach. Again, we talked about the husband and one wife. Temperate, prudent, respectable, hospitable, apt to teach, not a drunkard, not pugnacious, not, you know, like argumentative, gentle, uncontentious, free from the love of money, maintaining a well-managed home, not just a new convert, and a good reputation outside of the church. Now, I wonder if our elder candidates are going, wait a minute, do I qualify? And I wonder if our current elder is going, wait a minute, do I qualify? Because I know every time I read the list, I go, wait a minute, do I qualify? Because I can't say that I am, you know, all those are fully, I've embraced any of those fully, because we all sin and fall short of God's glory. So let's put a pin in that. So let's go to deacons. And then if you look at what the deacons, their one responsibility is a ministry of compassion and love towards those who are in need within the community and within the church. Here it has sympathy, mercy, service. Those are wonderful three words. Great. But they have responsibilities too. And as we read in 1 Timothy 3, 8 and 9, it's in 1 Timothy 3, 8 and 9, deacons likewise must be dignified, not double-tongued, not addicted to much wine, not greedy for dishonest gain. They must hold the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. Okay, now our deacon candidates are asking yourselves, wait a minute, do I qualify? And our current deacons, wait a minute, do I qualify? And the answer is, according to that list, according to your own efforts, the answer is, no, you don't. None of us do. But Jesus said what is impossible with man is possible with God. Jesus tells us that he has not called us because we're perfect. He's called us because we're broken. And he's put us back together to service his kingdom by seeking to serve God by serving others. Now, that's elders and deacons, but the members have requirements too. When you became a member of the church, you took some vows. And those vows were saying, yes, I believe Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. I believe I will submit myself to the governance of the authority of this church. I will seek to pursue the peace and unity of the church and the purity of the church. That's what I'm saying I'm committing to. I will participate actively. And by doing this, we're piecing together a church that multiplies. But a church that multiplies, so let's go back to our Mark passage. Go out into the world and proclaim the gospel to all creation. So when we had the three circles seminar, that's what we were seeking to do. And it wasn't just elders and deacons. We had members of the church there. We had people not even belong to the church there. Praise God. But it should have just ended there, focusing on God's design, our brokenness, and Jesus as a Savior providing salvation. We're going to go into that later on, not this sermon, but in another message, we're going to start breaking that down so that even if you were not at that seminar, you're going to hear it again. Because that is what we're called to do, to share the good news. So let's go to Truth 2.0, which is a little deeper, a little more focused on what we believe. Now, a guy named Brian Chappelle said, the church's greatest mistakes occur when people of God honor what a leader says without examining that instruction in the light of Scripture. someone proclaims themselves, I'm a Christian, come in and I've got a word to share, the first word you need to hear from them is, how are they speaking to what Scripture says? And if you can't hear it and you miss the point, what do we do? And again, this is where we come to the Timothy passage, 2 Timothy 4, 1 and 2. So Paul says, tells Timothy, in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing in his kingdom, praise God, I give you this charge. Simple. Preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. Do we get the point? Jesus is coming soon. Now, soon might be a relative term because soon back then is the same as soon today. It's been 2,000 years almost, but the day is coming when we don't know, but the day is coming. Praise God. And we are called to be ready. Because Paul says, I charge you, I challenge you. He's making a direct charge to Timothy, and in truth to us. Are we ready to accept this challenge? We can accept many challenges, don't we? We can accept the challenge of eating a spoonful of cinnamon, which we'll all spit out. We can take the ACL challenge again, dump with a bucket of ice water. We can accept many challenges, but are we willing to accept this challenge? This charge, because Paul has given it to us and Christ has given it to us, go into the world and proclaim the gospel to all creation. So the charge is preach the word. Don't preach yourself. Don't preach your opinion. Don't preach your personal experience. Don't preach your feelings and emotions. Don't preach your dreams, your visions, and revelations. None of that really matters. Preach the word. Now, true, can do we do it within our context? Sure. Do we do it through our understanding? Yes. Our personal experience? Certainly. Even our emotions and our feelings, but as I said, and I'm making the point, name what you're doing, but make sure the point stays the point. The main point stays the main point, which is God's word. All that is supplementary to propelling the point of what God is trying to tell us. That is the point we need to hold to. That is the word. And do this in seasons, as seasons change. So are we ready? In seasons change, you know, we can enjoy the summer. You know, I see people in short sleeves and in shorts and, you know, all that. That's great. No problem. But, you know, you could actually, if you have a preaching mind, and this is not just me or just anyone called to preach Sunday after Sunday, but each one of us, we could come up with very instantly, if we look at the seasons, what is a sermon we could preach in the spring? Rebirth, renewal. A sermon we could preach in the winter. A sermon we could preach in the summer and the autumn. Each one of those would have a sermon topic we could easily come up with. Sitting there, you probably have ideas in your mind. And that's what Paul is telling Timothy, be prepared. At any time, anywhere, in any situation, be prepared to proclaim the word. Three circles does that. Be ready to engage at any time, any circumstance, to share the good news. But when you do, there might be occasions, especially for those who proclaim the word on a regular basis, to reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Now, reproof is to correct a mistake. To rebuke is saying you're making that mistake, and exhort is to encourage you and to lift you up. And so every sermon, every message should reprove, rebuke, and exhort. Not specifically, not say, sorry, Keith, I want to use you. Keith is doing a bad thing. Let's all point out Keith. He's not. He's a really great guy. Going to be a great deacon. But that's not what they're saying. But if you see a tendency that something's going wrong, a correction needs to be made, you share it and you don't hesitate. And though it might not really be embraced, you do it nevertheless. But you encourage as well. I know I've said many times, I'm sure you've heard it from other sources, everything we do teaches. But the corollary to that was everything we do preaches. What we do tells people what we are and what we believe and who we belong to. If we're teaching, we're preaching. If we're preaching, we're teaching. And all that preaching and teaching needs to be surrounded in love. Love is patient, love is kind. And then we have another eight things love is not. And those eight things could be combined to say love is not pridefulness. Love is not self-centeredness. And the opposite of that is love is humbleness, humility. Knowing who you are as a sinner, knowing that Jesus Christ has redeemed you, and knowing he has called you to share that good news that he has saved you with others. And you do that in love. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. How true is that? Have you ever had an itching ear? Your ear just really itches? And you wonder it's just really bothering you? Well, what if that is, your ears itch to hear something new, something exciting, something, interesting? Because, oh my gosh, I'm not going to say who, but one of our elder candidates was saying, I've got a scripture verse, but I don't know if I want to use it. I said, what's a scripture verse? And he told me. I said, it's used so often. And I said, does it mean something to you? The answer was yes, then use it. Because no matter how often it's used, because it means something to other people, use it for yourself. How many times have I gone to a wedding and people say, I chose not to use 1 Corinthians 13 about love. Why? Because so many other people use it. Is it because it's window dressing or because the point is in a marriage about love? We already see this happening. People's ears are being itchy. They want something new, something exciting. And it doesn't often need to be about Jesus Christ. In fact, sometimes it shouldn't be about Jesus Christ in their mind, because Jesus Christ is always reproving, correcting, and rebuking. That's what they hear. They don't hear the encouragement and the exhortation. So that time is now. And those people, the only people who seem to want to change the gospel are those people who are unchanged by the gospel. And so you say, the Bible doesn't matter, scripture doesn't matter, the gospel doesn't matter. We don't really need it. Well, have they been changed by it? So that's why sound doctrine is important. Some people I know, our elder and deacon candidates, as well as all the elders and deacons, have all attended our 14-week elder deacon officer training. I know some might say, I'd never be a deacon if I have to do that. Well, many, if not most, if not all, have walked away saying, now I understand what it means to be A, Presbyterian, and B, Reformed. I get it. I understand. And that is important, because now they understand what we as a congregation are called to believe, and as a denomination, we are called to believe, which is lifted up from Scripture. Now, on the same time, there are times when all of us can have wrong thinking. And that's all right, if we're open to right thinking or correction. Kenny Rogers says, you got to know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to walk away, know when to run. I'll tell you, when I had to walk away and run away from a thought, I will go back to John Galliano. I had this concept of a soul sleep. I'm not going to go into it, but it was this concept. And I was really, really interested in it. And John says, what are you talking about? What's your point? Okay, let me try to make my point. And after I did, he says, now what was your point? And finally I said, okay, I'm going to find it in Scripture. And if I can't find it in Scripture, I'm going to find it in John Calvin. So I looked at Scripture and saw some examples that might be used. But then I looked at John Calvin, and he says, these are examples people use when it comes to this concept, soul sleep. Run, run as fast as you can away from this, because this is false. And he explained it, and I went, oh. And I told John that, and he says, I knew eventually you'd get it. And I can't say, much to the Gallardo family, how much I appreciated that. Because as an elder, as a member, as a Christian, he held me accountable. He held me accountable. And when I was initially pushing my thought, well, I think, show me in Scripture where your concept is clear. Accountability is essential. Because, again, when we look at Timothy, he says, do this, preach, do the work of an evangelist. And you're going to endure hardships, but you have to be sober in all things. But fulfill your ministry, because that's your calling. Do what you need to do, but do it in a way that proclaims the glory of God and not yourself. And when you think of what ministry is, it has so many different components. Humility, accountability, self-discipline, I could go on the list. Self-awareness, courage, it has so many things that you have to do. And this is just not just for the pastor or the preacher, this is for the elder and the deacon, but it's also for the Christian, for the ministry we have just as members of the church. This is what Paul's saying to us. But I will say there are times when you can be discouraged as a preacher. You know, when you wonder, did I make my point? Did people get the point? And so, but that can't be the focus, because we know discouragements are par for the course. There'll be times when you will speak in the word and no one might say anything. That's all right. But we got to remember God's work in our life, the continual calling we have. We have to identify the actual standard for what our ministry is supposed to be. And we got to ask ourselves, who am I trying to please? Am I trying to please God, give glory to him, or am I trying to please you? Lastly, pray, prepare, and preach. Preach what God gives you to proclaim. And if we do those five things, then suddenly we find our encouragement to grow up, to increase. Because as the song said, you know, alluded to, who am I? It comes from 1 Peter 1, 24-25. As the scripture says, people are like grass. Their beauty is like the flower in the field. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of the Lord remains forever. And that word is the good news that was preached to you. That's the point. And so as members and as elders and as deacons, as iron sharpens iron, so one person sharpens another. Your calling is to exhort one another and to reprove and rebuke and encourage me if I am off the rails of what I'm preaching and teaching. That's your call. Question is, are you doing it? Now, as I said, this year's elder and deacon training, I am so impressed, and every year I'm so impressed by our elder and deacon candidates and the time commitment they put on reading. There's so much stuff to read. There's the leadership training guide, which is over 100 pages. There's the book of order, which is, you know, mind-numbingly boring. There's the book of confessions, the Westminster Confession of Faith, a larger and shorter catechism. You know, to read that and to even remember a fraction of that takes a lot of time and a lot of effort. And year after year after year, and this year as well, I see the elders and deacon candidates to do that, embrace that. And I'm just so impressed by them. They're such an incredible witness. And every year they ask me questions and I got to go, wait a minute, let me think about that. And every year I grow in my own faith, grow in my own understanding because of the questions they ask. So I just love this period of time. And though it is long, it's a wonderful period of time of fellowship and getting to know each other as well as understanding. Because ultimately our point is to serve God by serving each other. To serve God by serving the members of this church and in the community. That is a point of what being an elder and a deacon and a pastor is all about. It says in John 13:35, your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. And as elders and deacons, we show love to each other and to the congregation. And that shows that we are disciples. And I conclude my message today with Romans 12:3. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. The point is never about us. The point is always to the glory of God. And if we hold on to that, to think about how are we glorifying God, we then serve God as God has called us to by serving the church. And in that, we truly are elders, deacons, pastors, and members seeking to grow his kingdom. In his holy name, amen. I would now like to call forward our elder and deacon candidates as we ordain and install them. I think we need three chairs up here. We got them? Oh, super. I'd like to call forward Kate Mincing, Carrie Richards, Andy Wonka, and Joyce Weber as our elder candidates, and Doreen Legg, Keith Loy, and Tom Richards as our deacon candidates. Now, I'm going to be asking them questions, and then they're called to affirm these questions, and then after that, I will ask the congregation a question. Do you affirm your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If so, say, I do. Do you believe the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be the Word of God, totally trustworthy, fully inspired by the Holy Spirit, the supreme, final, and the only infallible rule of faith and practice? If so, say, I do. Do you sincerely receive and adopt the Westminster Confession of Faith and the Catechism of the Church as containing the system of doctrine taught in the Holy Scriptures? If so, say, I do. Do you promise that if at any time you find yourself out of accord with the system of doctrine as taught in the Scriptures and as contained in the Westminster Confession of Faith and the Catechism of this Church, you will, on your own initiative, make known to your church session the change which has taken place in your views since the assumption of this ordination vow? If so, say, I do. Do you affirm and adopt the essentials of our faith without exception? If so, say, I do. Do you subscribe to the government and discipline of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church? And for elders, do you promise subjection to your fellow presbyters in the Lord? And for the deacons, do you promise subjection to your fellow officers in the Lord? If so, say, I do. Have you been induced, as far as you know your own heart, to accept the office of ruling elder or deacon from love of God and sincere desire to promote his glory and the gospel of his Son? If so, say, I have. And do you promise to be zealous and faithful in promoting the truths of the gospel and the purity and peace of the church, wherever, whatever persecution or opposition may arise to you on that account? If so, say, I do. And will you seek to be faithful and diligent in the exercise of all your duties as a ruling elder or as a deacon, whether personal or a relative, private or public, and to endeavor by the grace of God to adorn the profession of the gospel in your manner of life, and to walk with exemplary piety before this congregation, of which God will make you an officer? If so, say, I will. And lastly, are you now willing to take responsibility in the life of this congregation as a ruling elder or as a deacon? And will you seek to discharge your duties relying upon the grace of God in such a manner or in such a way that the entire Church of Jesus Christ will be blessed? If so, say, I will. And to you, the congregation, do you, the members of this congregation, receive these people as ruling elders and as deacons, and do you promise to yield to them all and all the officers all that honor, encouragement, obedience to the Lord to which the ordination as an officer entitles them according to the Word of God and the Constitution of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church? So say, I do. Praise God. Now, will you please kneel or sit? And will the ruling elders please come forward to lay hands? We got Joyce? Okay, good. Okay, everybody? Okay, super Tom. Praise God. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we ask your blessings upon these seven individuals. For Kate and Carrie, for Joyce and for Andy as elders. For Doreen and for Keith and for Tom as deacons. Bless them in their ministries. Let them know that you have touched them. And their calls have been affirmed by this congregation and by others. Let them find joy in the calling, find joy in the serving, and find joy in knowing that they are serving you by serving this congregation and others. We ask this, your blessings upon them, your continuous presence with them, and your love for them each and every day. For the elders of this church and for the deacons of the church, we ask for the same, to encourage us as your leaders to do for this congregation what you would have us do, knowing that we are called for your sake and not our own. So bless us, keep us in all things, in your son's holy name, amen. I got to say this, by the authority of the Evangelical Presbyterian Church and the church session of this congregation, I declare to you that these individuals have been ordained to the office of ruling elder or deacon, have been properly installed in that office, agreeable to the word of God and the laws of this church. As such, they are entitled to be given support, encouragement, honor, and obedience in the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise God. Get up. I would invite the seven to stand with me as the congregation leaves, and for everyone else now to return to your seats. Let us go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you. We thank you so much for your love, and we thank you so much for your presence in our lives each and every day. Lord, we ask your blessings to be with the Diaz and the Lentz family and the Southern Pastor of Connie and Kathy. Be with Susie and Bob Dempsey as they lament that loss. Please be with Holly and Isaac Apino, friends of Brandon Simmers. Isaiah Primo, who lost his mother, who was a pastor of a Lutheran church back where they live. And now he has no other surviving parents because his dad passed away last year. We ask you to be with those individuals and give all the family the knowledge that you are present with them in a powerful way, showing them your love each and every day, and helping them know that their loved ones are with you until we come before you and they to be rejoined, again, proclaiming you each and every day. Lord, we thank you for the wonderful VBS we had. We also look forward to a wonderful summer's best 2 weeks. We thank you for the officer training and the diligence that was put forth in that, and for our new elders and our new deacons. Again, we say goodbye to elders and deacons who've done such a wonderful job and ask your presence with them as well. Lord, be with Bob Hawk as he continues to recover from his back surgery. Let him know we miss him terribly. Be with his friend Melissa Malone, who has heart and health issues. Lord, be with Nathan Wheeler, a friend of the church who, a person that someone has asked us to pray for. Be with them. And be with Ron Gesser, who has his left kidney removed and is recovering. And we rejoice that Dave Nickel has had a wonderful birthday. Lord, continue to be with Alice Tashwa's granddaughter, Adeline. Be with Terry Nicholson as she continues to enjoy good health. We praise you for that. We thank you so much that Tom was with us today, Tom Fox. And be with him as he investigates whether he's going to have the surgery, but let him know you are present with him each and every day. Be with Bob Strider, Rich Mills' brother-in-law, who's not doing well. With Mike and Donna Carney, who's spending 2 weeks in Virginia Beach. We thank you that Mike's recovered so well from his surgery, and Donna's infusions are coming to an end. Now she has to deal with knee pain. Lord, be with Doreen Legg's niece, Melissa, who has some heart issues and some insurance concerns. We thank you for the Galeotto and the Costa families who had a wonderful time in North Carolina, and that Jen is doing well and recovered from surgery, and be with Marie as she is interning down in North Carolina. Be with Patty as she's continuing to recover her foot. Patty Wonka's foot is continuing to heal. Be with Tommy and Debbie Bekovac. Be with Nancy Ritchie's grandson, Matthew, who graduated from Marine Corps Officer Training course and did real well. Kay Benizak, as her shoulder is recovering, and with Amy Hines, who has test results, but still needs to determine what's going on. We ask your blessings on Adam and Emil's aunt, Vicky, who's struggling and not doing well with her cancer, but with Adam and Cassie as they await their first child. And Lord, be with the Benders and with their brother Dan, their niece Amy, and their friend Lillian. Be with Jackie Kanat, who's having some severe side effects with her chemo from breast cancer. And Lord, with all those who have illness or injury, depression or anxiety, private hurt and pain, or confronting life's difficult decisions, please give them the hope and the assurance that you are there with them each and every day. Lord, we ask your presence to be with us. Give us your strength, give us your love, and let each one of us know that you are present with us each and every day, for you love us and you have plans for our future and our hope. We ask us all this in your Son's holy name. We toss a prayer together by saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Christian friends, our offering baskets are in the back. People have already left their offerings. We thank you. As you'd like to leave, if you'd like to leave something for something that's appreciated as well, those on Zoom and YouTube and audio later, please send your offerings in as we seek to be a church that proclaims the word and seeks to serve the community. Let us pray. Okay. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for these gifts. Thank you so much for your love. And thank you so much for your Son, Jesus Christ, who opens our hearts to return to you that proper portion, that exaggerated portion of what you've given to us. So, Lord, bless us in your Son's holy name. Thank you. Christian friends, we have our fellowship. Please stay for that. The fellowship committee has done a great thing, and that's the fourth mark of a true church, is fellowship, where fellowship is maintained. Christian friends, as we go out into the world as elders, as deacons, as members of the church, let at all times in every way proclaim the good news. You might not have to preach up here, but we are called to proclaim the gospel out there, every one of us. Let us do that for God's glory. And by the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God's, the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Jesus Christ in our lives each and every day. Amen.